A warm greetings on behalf of principal, faculty, and students to all the nursing fraternity. We are highly privileged to organize this webinar on twinning challenges, COVID-19 and mucormycosis. At present, we experience the second wave of COVID-19, which has affected India substantially and continues to achieve stability over the existing situation. The incidence of mucormycosis, black fungus, has risen more rapidly during the second wave compared with the first wave of COVID-19. The recent unanticipated distressful emergencies of life-threatening mucormycosis in severe and critically ill COVID-19 patients has taken everyone into shock. The majority of the cases of mucormycosis are not occurring in the active phase of COVID-19, but develops as post-COVID-19 complications. This has raised serious concern both for medical mycologists and healthcare professionals. The challenge seems to be bigger since mucormycosis, if not controlled, can further augment the susceptibility of infected patients to more fatal systemic pathogenic infections. Multiple states in India already having declared it as an epidemic and a notifiable disease to the national health authorities, and as it is on the rise. So this webinar has been planned, which will enable our nurses to gain more knowledge on medical and nursing management of these patients. I wholeheartedly welcome our prolific leader, Dr. A. Jayasudha, principal, who is a strong motivator of all our endeavors. We welcome you, ma'am. It's a great pleasure to introduce our generous guest speaker of today's webinar, Dr. Anand, head of cochlear implant, PSG Super Speciality Hospitals, who's going to address on mucormycosis and emerging challenge in COVID-19. We welcome you wholeheartedly, sir. A warm welcome to other guest speakers, Dr. Deepika, initiative nurse, Glanchels Global Health City, Chennai, and Ms. Asumta, nurse educator, PSG Hospitals, for going to explore on mucormycosis in COVID-19 patients. A narration. We welcome both of you. Indeed, it is an immense privilege to welcome the faculty, nursing staffs, and students of various institutions in and around India and Tamil Nadu. I welcome you all once again. To introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Anand. He graduated from Madurai Medical College. He worked under Dr. Mohan Kameshwaran, a world-renowned ENT surgeon from Chennai. He is a member of various associations like European Pulsar Society of Otology, World Sleep Association, Cochlear Implant Group of India, etc. He has presented several papers in national and international conferences and conducts cadaver hands-on workshop in regular intervals. At present, he is the head of the cochlear implant department in PSG Institute of Medical Sciences and Research Center. He is also the director of head of ENT in Dr. Anand ENT Specialty Center and Academic Training Institute, Coimbatore. Sir, we are extending a warm welcome to you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So good morning to everyone. So I'm Dr. Anand, consultant in PSG Hospital as well as my own hospital in Coimbatore. Today, so I'm really thankful to the organizers for this wonderful meeting. So can I share my screen?
Yes, sir.
So today, actually, so already we are suffering with COVID-19. So this mucormycosis is another worst disease, actually. So it's worse than COVID. So even COVID, we can cure the disease. But mucormycosis, suppose we miss it in the early stage, definitely the cure is not possible. It's a very dreadful disease. So what is the association between mucormycosis and COVID? This is not a key. Mucormycosis, we can talk even 1 or 2 days, actually. So this is just half an hour speak. I can elaborate what is mucormycosis, how it is happening. So what is the solution to get rid of this disease, actually? First of all, I want to thank you, Principal Dr. Sudha, as well as the organizers, and as well as the other speakers also. Okay. So mycormycosis, what is mycormycosis? It's actually a fungus. So this fungus is there everywhere, even in our fingers, even our nose, even our mouth, actually, even the surface, even in the laptop, everywhere the fungus is there. Why now it is very common, actually? I don't know. Actually, maybe it is the immunosuppression state induced by the COVID, or maybe the variant of the COVID strain, or maybe the some other reason, actually. Still, we are actually working on it, actually. Why mycormycosis now it is very common. So this ubiquitous fungus, which exists freely in nature, is very aggressive as well as very progressive disease. So we have to identify in the early stage, otherwise definitely, so we are going to miss the life of the patient, actually. Okay. So this is actually the species called Mycorrhiza. Subphylum is Mycormycotina. So it's actually is a microbiology. Under order Mycorrhiza, mycormycosis can only be caused by member of blanks to 7 families. So the most common among these families includes family Mycorrhizaceae. So this is a microbiology. I will go into the details, actually. So this in India, so a lot of subspecies, actually. This is epithet, actually. Rhizopus oraceae is a western hemisphere. Rhizopus pulsatilis. And these are the common organism, but normally in India now this we are seeing is Rhizopus oraceae. Actually, it's common in Western Hemisphere now. It's also common in India now. So this is the pathogenesis. Actually, pathogenesis. Actually, why it is common in nowadays? Actually, why it is very rare in early stage? Actually, but is there? We are seeing cases of mycormycosis maybe once in 6 months or maybe 1 or 2 cases in a year, actually. So it's a very common in diabetes mellitus patient, extremely diabetic ketoacidosis patient, in organ transplant patient, in very neutropenic immunosuppression patient, sometime actually in cancer patient, actually. So now it's very common because of the COVID-19, maybe 2 reasons. One is actually, so we are inducing the organism inside, actually. Okay, and otherwise, development of hyperglycemia in COVID patient. Maybe steroid therapy as well as the COVID strain itself, it affects the pancreas and increase the glucose level. Normally, is a non-diabetic patient, suppose after COVID, suppose we check the sugar level, maybe 500 and 600. So COVID itself caused the hyperglycemia. So it may be the cause, or immunosuppression state, or maybe the variant, maybe the B variant as well as the Delta variant is actually more dangerous. Itself stimulate the fungus to grow inside, actually. Lot of pathogenesis are actually, there are coined actually. The more common pathogenesis, hyperglycemia and increased free iron level in the body. These more are very, actually, they favor for growth of fungus inside the nose as well as inside the body. So this iron content, this is the hypothesis actually commonly now put forward for development of mycormycosis in the body. The total amount of free iron in the body is important feature to determine the risk of development of mycormycosis. The iron actually engages the survival of fungus inside the body, thus increase the risk actually. So a lot of chelating agent, desferoxamine, should not be used actually. A lot of patients actually, we are giving continuous blood transfusion as well as we are giving a ferritin, increased ferritin level by folate intake actually. These are the actually risk factor to develop of mycormycosis in them actually. So desferoxamine acts as siderophore for the fungus, provides iron directly to the fungus. Iron increases the growth of fungus. So whenever there is an increased iron content in the body, there are risks to develop mycormycosis actually. Diabetes mellitus, risk of development of mycormycosis increase with the presence of diabetes, actually very well known. So this is one of the most common predisposing factor to development of mycormycosis, hyperglycemia and metabolic acidosis. Normally nose, the pH is the acidic actually. So fungus growth in acidic pH. So whenever the acidic pH increase dryness of the nose or maybe increase the sugar level in the body, in the pH in the body increase, so they go for a acidosis. Whenever there is acidosis there, mycormycosis increase in the body. So we have to reduce the acidosis by maybe saline wash or increase the body alkaline status, maybe so reduce the growth of the mycormycosis in the body, but it's not at all possible because actually, so hyperacidosis, we can't reduce the acidosis by simple alkaline diet or maybe simple medication. So almost same actually, diabetic ketosis, the blood pH decreases, so going for acidosis as a result of which iron sequestering proteins actually. This increased availability of iron to the growing mica, the increased virulence and the survival so of the mica process. Hyperglycemia, increased glucose level in the blood cause glycation of the iron sequestering protein, as a result of which iron is released actually. So indirectly, diabetic ketoacidosis, as well as hyperglycemia, increased iron content of the body. So it increased the growth of the mucormycosis. And another these things, the upregulation of GRP78, it's a mammalian receptor, which is used by the fungus to penetrate into the tissue. This is also there. So a lot of actually now the drugs to downregulate this receptor, which helps to decrease the disease actually. So points to remember, there are some key points to remember before accessing the risk factor of mucormycosis. Patient with elevated blood sugar, so may be due to corticosteroid therapy, which we are commonly using in COVID patient. The only available drug is a steroid. Steroid decrease the lung involvement, so we have to use the steroid. So it's a larger quantity to treat the mucormycosis, to treat the COVID patient. So it's not common in COVID, in wave one actually. So there's a lot of questions asked. Why this is very common in wave two, not common in wave one, and why it is very common in India and not in actually in abroad actually. These are the questions still actually remaining an answer actually. So wave one actually, the variant is different. Now this variant is different. Because of this variant, the elevated sugar level as well as the increased iron content back. So promote the growth of mucormycosis in the body. So we are working on that actually. Why this variant is very virulent to develop mucormycosis? Not the mucormycosis alone, a lot of intestinal gangrenes are coming now. A lot of arthritis is coming now. So a lot of patients are there going for impotence after the COVID infection actually. So still is a mystery to answer a lot of questions actually. But the mucormycosis is the deadly disease. Suppose we go to treat early is not possible. Definitely we are going to lose the life of the patient actually. The reduced immunity as a result of malignancy or massive development of MICAR. Cutaneous form of MICAR develops as a result of road traffic accident, nosocomial lesion, and laceration of skin actually. So prophylaxis actually now a lot of patients actually, so they are taking antifungal therapy to get rid of this deadly disease, but it's not a good idea. So itraconazole and voriconazole is not recommended and in fact is dangerous. It may stimulate MICAR mycosis and it's an isolated, located mucormycosis can develop as a disseminated mucormycosis in some individual. So that's why without proper advice of the doctor, don't take any antifungal treatment as your own actually. Okay. So clinical manifestation, so this mucormycosis can present as a 5 forms actually, but common one is a rhino-orbital cerebral disease, some spelling mistake, pulmonary disease and gastrointestinal disease and cutaneous disease and disseminated and miscellaneous disease. Okay, this rhino-orbital cerebral disease is a very commonly seen nowadays. Actually, we are seeing a lot of patients, all patients used to come with orbital swelling and facial swelling. Very common in patients with the diabetic ketoacidosis, high level of steroid usage and transplant patient now very common in post-COVID. Invariably after 15 days or maybe after 21 days, all post-COVID patients, they are coming now with eye swelling and facial swelling and there is invariably pain in the teeth actually. These are the common 3 symptoms they usually come with actually. So very common after 15 days. So last month actually we operated almost 20 cases of mucormycosis. All patients used to come with the orbital swelling, facial swelling and invariably this dental numbness and severe pain actually over the 1 or 2 teeth actually. Okay, these are the common manifestation of this rhino-orbital mucormycosis. Cerebral involvement is very rare. Suppose we actually miss the diagnosis, definitely it will enter into the cerebellum via foramen ovale or maybe via the optic nerve actually. Once you involve the optic nerve, it crosses the opposite side, involve the cavernous sinus. So we are going to lose the vision of both eyes actually. These are the common symptoms. One is eye pain, facial numbness on the periella region, conjunctival puffiness or subfusion, blurry vision, fever. Almost all patients, they used to complain fever and body pain. There is increased level of WBC. Normally we are going to miss actually. In COVID, there is a decreased level of WBC. There is any increased level of white count, there is definitely auto suspicion of development of some disease, another disease in the body, maybe mucormycosis actually. So normal commonest site of involvement is the inferior terminate and ethmoid sinus. So symptom is involves the orbit, So it erodes the lamina papyracea and periceptal area and involves the fat. Common finding in MRI is that fat standing in the periorbital area is the commonest finding on mucormycosis. So the symptoms is proptosis, chemosis, sometimes actually blurring of vision, suppose involves the extraocular muscles, the movement of orbit is restricted. Suppose involves the intraconal, definitely there we are going to lose the vision of the patient. Ophthalmoplegia, bilateral proptosis, suppose is a sign of cavernous sinus thrombosis, involvement of cerebrum actually. Okay. Progressions, normally tissue appears normal. Suppose we do endoscopy in all these patients, the nose is absolutely normal. There will be no actually this thing, only one or two area, there is a white scar. White scar is a classical sign of actually this mucor. It's early stage, it's the avascular stage. So normal, then slowly erythema stage, then this villosius appearance, then block necrotic scar. Block necrotic scar because of the necrosis of the area. So normally, this fungus involves the blood vessels and block the blood vessel by thrombotic development. When the thrombosis is there, there will be avascular field, so necrosis. First, initially, white thick scar, then it's turned into the black necrotic scar. When seen on hot pellet, so this extends is spread. Pulmonary disease is the second common one. Still, I will be able to see actually because this rhinoceric orbital is a very common form. Still, we have to see if there is any pulmonary disease. But actually, once pulmonary macular disease, definitely we are not going to save the patient actually. So, dyspnea, cough, chest pain, and fever. These are the commonest symptoms in pulmonary macular. Manifestation, angioinvasion, necrosis, cavitation, hemoptysis, lobar consolidation, isolated masses, and visceral masses and bronchiectasis. Actually, definitely, this is a CT finding. If any patient comes with severe hemoptysis and dyspnea and cough, chest pain after the COVID-19, so we have to think about pulmonary mucormycosis also. Cutaneous, actually, hematogenous spread, some external implantation by surgical, iatrogenic, or maybe some road traffic accident, actually. Gastrointestinal mucormycosis is very rare actually. So in neonates is very common actually. So a disseminated disease, necrotizing enterocolitis in adults mainly acute through the nasocomial means actually. It's not by actually by natural inhalation. It's maybe nasocomial means actually. Suppose infected food or maybe some accidental ingestion of something, so can develop intestinal mucormycosis actually. Symptom non-specific abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, and GI bleeding. Actually, a lot of patients, so actually we are seeing with the rhino orbital mucormycosis, they are complaining a lot of chest pain as well as a lot of abdominal pain. So we have to think about some maybe development of involvement of this structure, but we have to go a little further for investigation. Can be observed as a black necrotic mass through endoscope actually. So these are the findings in endoscopic images of gastrointestinal mucormycosis. So disseminated spread, hematogenous dissemination originate from any particular site, commonly from nose. It involves a periopalatine fossa, the internal maxillary artery is the major artery which supplies the nose actually. So via the internal maxillary artery, it goes into the brain and to the organ actually. Most commonly the brain. Mortality rate is 100%. So it involves the brain. So definitely there will be a no cure for this actually. So diagnosis, always high index of suspicion. So last week, yesterday also I saw a patient actually, referred from Aravind Eye Hospital actually, so with the loss of vision one night, with the involvement of hot pellet and everything, almost this patient went to the dentist continuously attending the dental OPD, and they removed two teeth actually, so with the shaking teeth, that was a very severe pain, they removed the teeth actually. But with no suspicion of anything actually, mucormycosis or something else actually. And finally, actually, so the patient developed eye symptom, then they went to the ophthalmologist. The ophthalmologist suspect actually, so something else is not a eye problem actually. Then they took MRI, then finally they landed a diagnosis of mucormycosis. Then they referred to us actually. So this high index of suspicion is like very, very important. Once you have a suspicion of mucormycosis, you have to go for MRI. MRI is the only investigation of choice to diagnose mucormycosis in the early stage. In late stage, you can diagnose with the normal endoscopy as well as normal CT scan, but in the early stage, MRI will give a only clue Okay, something else is definitely a fungal infection. Okay, hence when a culture is grown, specimens should be collected from sterile condition. Normally, what we are doing actually during intraoperative stage, or maybe if there is a doubtful diagnosis, we are taking a culture and send for a KOH mount for a fungal culture and diagnosis. Actually, condition is urgent. The treatment should be started before confirmation of diagnosis. Once you see any black eschar or bloody brownish discharge from the nose and involvement of eye and face and numbness of the teeth, actually, so simultaneously take a culture and specimen and we start your treatment. So the treatment not going to be changed. So only suppose it's not fungus is negative, or we are going to stop the antifungal treatment. Otherwise, the treatment is the surgery only to get rid of this deadly disease. So this is a so classical finding of actually so intraoperative finding. I once I press over the middle medial area, see the pus. Actually, it's a normal pus is actually yellow color. This pus is a brown is white. Actually, it's a classical finding of mucormycosis. Actually, hello.
Yeah, sir. We could see your video.
Yeah. Okay. This is an intraoperative finding. So once we open the maxillary sinus, actually we exactly see this is this thing of actually classical pandemic. Are you able to see the black this fungus inside?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So it's a classical finding of mucormycosis actually. So normal sinus, it is a normal sinusal polyposis. The finding is totally different. This usually involves the maxillary sinus and alveolus part of the maxilla and surround the lamina papyracea as they enter through the orbita. This is the classical intraoperative finding of mycosis. Then normally histopathology, so we can identify what type of fungus. Is a white fungus, is aspergillosis, or a black fungus, is a mycormycosis. The culture media, so species identification. Culture is KOH mount, or this dextrose or SDFR is the culture normally. So what we are using in the lab actually. Biopsy with the histopathology, we can see the specific type of fungus. So what is the aseptic or septic? What is the exact angulation of this hyphae? Periodic acid soot test, methamine silver, and using hematoxin stain. These are the stain they are using in this thing. These are the classical finding of mucormycosis. The thick-walled ribbon-like aseptic. Actually, this is very classical finding of mucormycosis. Aspergillosis, actually, a lot of septa is there. In between, like a bamboo sticks, a lot of septa is there in mucormycosis. There is aseptic. Hyphae branch at right of exact right angles, it's a hyphae branches would be there. It's a classical kind of mucormycosis. But the imaging technique, MRI and CT are considered gold standard for identification. In gastrointestinal disease, the endoscopy is the only finding. Orbital involvement, MRI, CT. In high-risk patients, surgical exploration is done actually. MRI is the investigation of choice. It's a classical finding. Actually, this opacification of maxillary sinus. And eighth model black arrow sinus with a scattered high density area patient with mucormycosis actually. So this is a classical MRI finding of mucormycosis. So diagnosis imaging, roller imaging is detects the fungal angioinvasion. So the erosion of orbit or erosion of any orbital muscle or maxilla involvement of the premaxillary area. Because premaxillary is a cheek actually below the cheek. So all finding we can easily so pick it out from MRI actually. So bone destruction, softest involvement, and intracranial involvement. So this we can find. One, the intracranial involvement is very deadly spread actually already. CT PNS and MRI PNS with brain and orbit. Normally what we are ordering is MRI, orbit, and brain. So this actually we can easily find out the extent of the disease and how early we have to clear, how much we have to clear actually. Suppose normal barrier, we open the normal barrier, may enter to the normal barrier and we can give a path to so disseminate actually. That's why actually MRI is important. So only involvement port to be able to remove. So non-involvement normal part, don't touch it actually. MRI provides better delineation of blood vessels, orbital invasion, and intracranial extension. So MRI is the investigation of choice actually. There are a lot of differential diagnoses, but still actually is not very common in India. So the important thing is white fungus or black fungus. White fungus is not a very aggressive like mucormycosis, but easily so we can identify with the intraoperative finding. Black fungus, suppose we leave it for 1 or 2 days, it can develop into the disability stage like orbital invasion or maybe involvement of brain actually. So mucormycosis and adbusillus, normally these two is very different because actually treatment is totally different between these two fungus actually. Suppose we are giving a treatment for actually adbusillus, so for mucormycosis treatment of adbusillus definitely is very dangerous. Suppose actually it will aggravate the growth of maybe wheat fungus. So mucormycosis is exclusively treatment and only one drug of choice available in throughout the world actually is amphotericin B. For adbusillus actually voriconazole, actually this variconazole are so won't act in mucormycosis. So the differentiation between mucor and adbusillus is very important before going into the treatment actually. Thick walled ribbon like aseptate, so perpendicular hypal element. This is a thin wall, lot of septates there. 45 degree hypal element. This is a 90 degree, this is a 45 degree. So this is a histological finding, but okay, there's microbiologists, they can help us actually to identify which fungus is there, if there is any doubtful diagnosis. Otherwise, so intraoperative finding gives a 100% diagnosis, you can start your therapy immediately at the day of surgery actually. So aspergillus, this is a septate and 45 degree angulation, is a no septate and 90 degree angulation in mucormycosis. So coming to the treatment actually, the treatment part is very important. Suppose we are seeing a patient in the morning, definitely we are taking the patient for surgery in the afternoon itself. So aggressive surgery, antifungal therapy and follow up the patient. These are the three steps actually normally. So what we are following. So management, yearly surgical debridement actually, antifungal therapy and control of underlying risk factor. Actually, one mucor patient suppose, so only surgery is not a solution for them. Actually. Surgery, we can stop the load of disease and we can stop the further spread. So already angioinvasion or maybe sometime actually some involvement of muscle or maybe fat, maybe they for that actually only this antifungal therapy will going to address. Even these two is not enough. Underlying control of disease, maybe suppose a neutropenic patient, we have to improve the condition, immunosuppression patient, improve the immunity, and diabetic patient, we have to control the diabetes. So all these together, so it's a team actually. So all these together, so can help to get rid of the disease actually. Early surgical interventions also improve survival actually. Surgery, normally what we are doing is endoscopic sinus surgery. Simultaneously, if there is any orbital involvement, we would address the orbit. So at that time, definitely we would seek the help of the ophthalmologist. If there is involvement of extraconal, there's nothing to worry. So just a clearance of the fat and muscle is enough. Involvement of the intraconal is the involvement of the optic nerve. So definitely we would take the orbit out actually. Otherwise, it may lead to spread into the brain and opposite eye also. Then we are going to lose the vision of both eyes. It's very, very dangerous actually. So definitely, so if there is involvement of orbit, definitely we have to sacrifice the orbit. Otherwise, we are going to lose the life of the patient actually. If the involvement of palate, we have to remove the palate also. We have to remove the alveolus and all the teeth are one side of the palate. Sometimes with involvement of the both side of the palate, we have to remove the complete palate. So after 1 or 2 months, we have to ask our dental colleagues actually to give the implant or process for them actually. Sometimes you have to need the help of a maxillofacial surgeon to remove the involvement of teeth actually. So if there is intracranial split, nowadays actually in our setup actually, we are not doing any intracranial surgery for mucormycosis. The reason is isolated frontal abscess or temporal lobe abscess or in there is any isolated middle cranial fossa, definitely our neurosurgery colleagues actually, they are helping us to remove the disease actually. If there is intracranial spread and involvement of actually only localized abscess, we can definitely ask them. Definitely they can help us to remove the localized abscess. There is involvement of huge area as well as disability spread in the brain, definitely. So surgery is not the only option actually for them. Antifungal therapy is intravenous amphotericin B and oral posaconazole and oral isavuconazole. These are the drugs. They are also IV forms are available. So the first line therapy always amphotericin. So second line is isavuconazole and third line is the posaconazole and fourth line is only ceftriaconazole. Ceftriaconazole actually only very limited action in mucormycosis, but all these other drugs are, they have a wonderful action in mucormycosis. This amphotericin is three forms are there. One is conventional form, it's very dangerous, so highly nephrotoxic, and lipid formulation, so then AMB collateral dispersion actually. So the lipid formulation, liposomal, is actually wonderful, this thing. This is actually less nephrotoxic, actually very safe to use actually. Otherwise, a lot of reactions are coming like hyperthermia, vomiting and loose motion, blurring of vision, should be a headache. So these are the side effects of on-board testing actually. So normally on-board testing, we have to calculate according to the patient weight actually. So we have to see the urinary parameter as well as the kidney parameter as well as sugar level. So all actually 14 days we have to follow them. 14 days we have to give a IV on-board testing actually. After 14 days, so we have to start a oral therapy for at least 45 days. Complication of mucormycosis, there is a neurological defect, sometime intracranial involvement, some maybe skull-based cranial involvement. We can treat the disease, but some neurological defects will be there. Blindness, cerebral thrombosis, stroke, anosmia, and cavernous thrombosis, internal carotid artery thrombosis. This is a very deadly disease. Internal carotid artery thrombosis, definitely we are going to lose the patient. Summary, cerebro-rhino-orbital mucormycosis is the most common and most aggressive form of mucormycosis. So normally, surgical part, this is for our surgical colleagues actually, involvement of pterygium faldeum fossa, this is a common reservoir for mucormycosis. Internal maxillary artery is the commonest artery that involves in mucormycosis. This is the source of actually mucormycosis spread to another area. So we have to address that this pterygium faldeum fossa in all cases, even though it's not involved, we go to see whether it's look for any involvement. So removal of this reservoir from this stage definitely going to help save the life of the patient. Radical surgical debridement, antifungal therapy, correction of underlying metabolic and impaired neurological status are necessary to improve the survival. Systemic amputation B is the only drug of choice to treat them actually. So this nowadays, this amputation B is not available everywhere. They're getting only 10 to 15 vials per patient actually. This is not enough actually. We have to give at least 80 vials for each patient to achieve a correct dosage to cure the mucormycosis. Thank you so much. Okay, so that's all. If there is any questions, I am happy to address the question.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. We have a few queries, sir. Actually, one study shows that the unhygienic oxygen delivery as well as the unhygienic practices leads to mucormycosis. Is there any?
So actually, still there is a study. Study is there, but actually, so this is against our this now common practice. That's why I didn't mention about that actually. So this mucormycosis actually there is increased usage of steroid definitely. Normally, all ICU patients. So we are using. Not unhygienic. Normally, we are using the distilled water to fill the this thing.
Humidifier.
That is in the same practice for more than 30s and 40 years. Why mucormycosis is not there at that time actually? So now actually very common. So it may be the cause, but that is the only, not only the cause. So unhygienic water. So everybody is mentioning, but my thing is actually, so we are using the same ICU, we are using the same water for all patients. So all patients are diabetic ketoacidosis. There is already immunocompromised patient. We were treated in the previous years, but MECOR is not common at that time. Only this time is very common, not because of that only practice of increased steroid, increased water. Maybe it's a variant of the COVID strain, not because of this practice actually. This is my opinion.
Okay. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. The another question is, they want to know the incidence of mucormycosis in solid organ transplantation, sir. Is there any
Actually, this is very rare, actually. We are actually treating a lot of organ transplant patients. Actually, they are coming for cerebral polyposis, actually. So, they are very, very careful. They are using not, actually, we are seeing patient of rheumatoid arthritis also. Rheumatoid arthritis, they used to give a steroid for life now actually. So the only drug is a steroid. So even rheumatoid arthritis patient, they can develop mucormycosis. I don't know the exact incidence of mucormycosis in organ transplant patient because it's very rare. So already I mentioned, we are seeing only one or two cases per year actually. So very rare.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And the participants, they have given the feedback as an excellent presentation with appropriate AVs and very informative also.
Okay, thank you so much.
Dr. Anand, thank you so much for the extensive, it was so elaboratively from basic to the higher level you have done your presentation. It was too good. And there was one more question, like they've asked, how to prevent this mucormycosis among diabetics or post-COVID people?
No, this actually, we are seeing patient after post-COVID, even high socioeconomic status patient also. Yesterday, I saw one patient, it's a doctor, retired doctor, as well as the father of a dentist, actually. They are very high socioeconomic status patient, actually. So they are meticulously maintaining their diabetic level. Everything is normal, but they develop mucormycosis. So I don't know what is the reason behind this. So nowadays, we are thinking about only the variant. So we can't prevent mucormycosis post-COVID patient, actually. So we can control the spread of the disease by maintaining the strict diabetic status, as well as nasal hygiene, actually. What I am doing, I'd say I'm forming a small protocol. This is not there everywhere in the book, actually. So whenever there is a nasal pH decrease, it will increase the growth of the mucormycosis. So increase the nasal pH by frequent alkaline wash, actually, and saline wash, alkaline wash, reduce steam intake. So, and the dryness definitely will reduce the growth of mucormycosis. So after post-COVID-19 patient, actually, so they have to use the saline drops frequently and frequently wash the nose with the a lot of normal saline, isotonic saline wash are there. They go to wash the nose. And if there is any collection or a sinus, it is like a discharge or anything, immediately they go to see the ENT doctor or any doctor to take the treatment. Don't use any steroid spray. So these are the advice they can take to prevent mucormycosis. So actually, truly speaking, is not because of the, this thing is a variant of the COVID strain, which is causing mucor. Because we experienced mucor, COVID first wave, at that time, no mucormycosis.
Yes.
So only after the second wave, this mucormycosis is coming as a huge number. Is because of the variant of the COVID strain, not because of this steroid, not because of the diabetes, not because of this, this thing. Nowadays, we are speaking like that, actually, but all these are a predisposing factor to develop mucormycosis. But not only this this thing is because of the variant of the COVID-19.
So much, doctor.
Okay. If there is any question, I can address. Otherwise, so till 2 or 3 minutes.
Doctor, is steam inhalation not advisable at all?
Yeah, steam inhalation increase the humidity, increase the nose actually. So whenever there is a humidity increase, definitely there is a chance of growth of the fungus. So otherwise, actually, it's the same. We are advising don't take zinc frequently. Zinc also increase the iron, this thing in the body, so it increase the growth of the mucor inside, actually. So all for post-COVID patient, not for normal this thing. For steam, frequent steam inhalation is not advisable. Maybe once in a day or maybe, so very, a lot of patients actually, they are taking steam inhalation for half an hour. It's not also advisable. Steam inhalation for just a minute or maybe 2 minutes is advisable. Taking steam for more than 5 minutes, 10 minutes is not a good idea.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, thank you. So with your permission, I can leave now. So
sure, doctor. Thank you so much for spending your valuable time with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I thank Dr. Anand for his excellent presentation. Next, we have the presenter, Ms. Deepika Selvakumar. Ms. Deepika has completed her undergraduate from MAM College of Nursing, Trichy, and post-graduation from PSG College of Nursing, Coimbatore. She started her career as staff nurse, scrub nurse in the cath lab and promoted as a nursing in charge of cath lab at Kaveri Hospitals, Trichy. She has attended various national and international conferences and workshops. At present, she is working as initiative nurse at Gleneagles Global Health City, Chennai. Deepika, I welcome you to take over the session.
Thank you, ma'am. Shall I share my screen now?
Yes, Deepika, you can share.
Is my screen is visible, ma'am?
Yes, it's visible. You can proceed.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning to one and all gathered here in this virtual forum. And I would like to thank my beloved principal, ma'am, Dr. A. Jayasudha, principal PhD College of Nursing. And I would like to thank my director of nursing, Dr. Jyoti Clara J. Michael, IHH India, and Ms. Rajila Selvakumari, our CNO, GGHC Chennai, and our Streamline Policy Nursing Core Committee team head, Ms. Jessica D'Souza, Chief Nursing Officer, CTKD Mumbai, and our initiative team, GGHC Chennai, and HAC Nursing Team, GGHC Chennai, and our Mucormycosis Task Force, IHH India, for presenting this presentation. And I would like to thank all the organizers for organizing this valuable topic on the Forum of Nursing Fraternities. So under IHH Healthcare India, we have 6 hospitals. So today we are going to see about prevention and nursing care of patients with mucormycosis in COVID-19 narration. The overview of my presentation was background why we are studying this in this forum, and terms and definitions, and nursing care of patients with mucormycosis, assessment, and what is the responsibility of a nurse in assessment, and what is the responsibility of a nurse in intervention, and how the outcome may be bring into a positive thing as a nurse we could see, and case study of a patient. So why we are addressing this mucormycosis in this forum is in India, this is a study which was published by CDC government. And in that, among 289 mucormycosis patients, 187, that is 65.2%, had COVID-associated mucormycosis. That it is stating that due to this pandemic, the incidence of mucormycosis is increasing. And while in this picture, you can see this is a clip of Hindu newspaper dated June 2nd, and 518 people affected by mucormycosis, in that 17 have died recently. So that is why we bring this topic into nursing forum. So sir has explained everything about the theoretical part. Only thing I'm going to cover here is about all the nursing care. And the most common mucormycosis, which is COVID-associated, are rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis. Shortly, we will call it as ROCM, and cutaneous and soft tissue mucormycosis, and pulmonary mucormycosis. So the nurse's role, how it is important, the proactive role of nurse is important in early detection and management of patient with mucormycosis. So we are going to see in a role of nurse in suspecting the COVID-associated mucormycosis, and what is the role of nurse in confirmation of diagnosis, and what is the role of nurse in plan of treatment, and what is the role of nurse in management of patient with mucormycosis, and how we can act as a counselor, and how we are going to reassess the patient, and how we are going to follow. So in suspecting COVID-associated mucormycosis, the nurse's role is prompt assessment. First one is we have to assess the predisposing factors and the risk factors and the history of previous and present illness and the clinically correlating symptoms and the physical examination. While saying about the predisposing factors, we have to see the three major thing. One is comorbidities, and that the most common thing is uncontrolled diabetes and concurrent or recently treated COVID, and hospital stay, prolonged hospital stay, and high doses of steroids using prolonged periods, and prolonged ventilation and oxygenation. And in the nosocomial infection, contaminated linen and improperly cleaned equipments. The clinical symptoms, we have to analyze this at the earliest. The symptoms of mucormycosis depends on the site of fungal infection, which includes face swelling and severe headache, nasal block or congestion, and eye swelling, nose discharge, pus discharge in the mouth and abscess in the mouth, and loose tooth or tooth pain or jaw pain, or blurred vision or double vision, or eye irritation and fever. If it is cutaneous, skin lesions and necrosis, that is blackish discoloration in the skin. Physical examination. How a nurse could see at the earliest symptoms through physical examination, the three things we can correlate. First one is oral examination. In that, we can see all the examination of the oral thing from the palate till the teeth, whether there is any sort of infection in the palate and any tooth pain or tooth erosion. And then in the ocular examination, we could see that ptosis and proptosis and eye swelling. And in the facial changes, you should see the puffiness of the face and periorbital edema. Role of nurse in confirmation of diagnosis. So these are all the investigation that we will do. And what is the role of nurse in confirmation of these diagnosis? And what is the role of nurse in collection of the sample that we are going to see? And first one is MRI plain with contrast ALK sequences with screening CT and CTPNS and orbit. So the nurse's role here is to check the renal profile prior to any contrast media invasion, and blood investigations and chest X-ray, ECG and 2D echo, and microbiology, pus or tissue. And the nurse's role here is tissue to be collected in sterile culture container with a sterile saline. And in that, you had to send for gram stain, fungal smear, Arabic culture, and fungal culture. Under the tissue sampling, preservative samples and tissue sample histopathology and microorbital plus intraocular contents. So role of nurse in confirmation of diagnosis, again, the collection of sample, the sample to be collected in which solutions, that the KOH staining and microscopy, it should be collected in saline to diagnose the presence of fungi, and fungal culture, the sample to be collected in saline to identify the type of fungi, and the histopathology, the sample to be collected in 10% formalin to diagnose fungus or bony lesions or malignancy. The specimen should be collected especially in sterile containers and to be transported within 2 hours for the laboratory. And avoid sending swabs if pus or sterile body fluid can be aspirated or when tissue can be obtained, and do not use dry swabs. The sample collection to be done according to the site of mucormycosis. If it's involving rhinoorbital cerebral mucosis, scraping or exudates from the nares and hot palatal lesions in sinus materials, and biopsy from the extracted tooth socket area, and endoscopy collection of debrided tissue, these are the appropriate investigation that we should collect for ROCM. And for cutaneous, aspiration with a sterile needle and syringe from the undrained abscess, and pus collected from the abscess, and tissue to be collected from the center as well as edge of the lesion. And for pulmonary mucormycosis, sputum and bronchoalveolar lavage, lung biopsy and thoracentesis. Role of nurse in plan of treatment. So here it's a multidisciplinary approach. The nurse should act as a case coordinator, and she should coordinate all other teams for the opinions. So from starting from the internal medicines for the diabetes diabetologist opinion on all the medicine review, and to the ophthalmology as it involves eye, and ENT as it involves paranasal sinuses also, and neurology and neurosurgery for the surgery, or if it involves the cerebral area, and infectious disease team plays a major role, and in identifying the antibiotics and antifungal therapy, those and all, and maxillofacial and dental, and pulmonology, plastic surgeon, postoperatively and for anesthesia. So it is a multidisciplinary team approach. So we, a nurse, should act as a case coordinator in plan of treatment. So this is the algorithm for management of mucormycosis. So if it is possible or proven or OCM, directly the patient will go for urgent surgical debridement. And for that patient, strict glycemic control plays a major role. So for that, the role of nurse in this is we have to control the glycemic status starting from the medication till the dietary advices and the medications, and followed by these medications. So the role of nurse in these medications is mainly giving the test dose, prehydration, and how to administer the drug with the correct dilution. So that we will see. The common antifungal agent that that is used for mucormycosis is amphotericin B deoxycholate. The dose is 1 mg per kg per day. 4 to 6 weeks, guided by the clinical response. And second one is liposomal amphotericin B, as Sad told. I also go with the point that it is commonly used for renal patient. It is commonly used to prevent nephrotoxicity, as amphotericin B or deoxycholate have major side effects. So instead of that, liposomal amphotericin B plays a major role nowadays. And the dosage is 5 mg per kg per day. And 4 to 6 weeks, guided by the clinical response. And the oral forms is voconazole 200 mg TDS per oral 2 days, followed by 200 mg OD 4 to 6 weeks, and posaconazole 300 mg BD per oral 1 day, followed by 300 mg OD 4 to 6 weeks, and itraconazole 200 mg TID 4 to 6 weeks, guided by clinical response. These are the dosages. And as a nurse, we have to know about the drug dilution and how to give test dose and all. So for injection amphotericin B deoxycholate, the test dose 1 mg in 100 ml D5 over 20 minutes, the test dose should be given. And the prehydration 500 ml NS over 30 minutes. And day one, 0.5 mg per kg in 100 ml D5 dextrose, that is 5% dextrose over 1 hour. And for day two, 0.75 mg per kg in 100 ml 5% dextrose over 2 to 3 hours. And for post hydration, again, you have to start 500 ml NS over 30 minutes. And you should watch urine output, renal function test, and fill the amphotericin monitoring sheet. That I'll show it in next slide. And for injection liposomal amphotericin B, the test dose, injection liposomal amphotericin B, one vial contains 50 mg, and it should be diluted in 12 ml of diluent, and 0.25 ml, that is about 1 mg of solution to be made, and to be again mixed with 100 ml of dextrose, and to be infused over 30 minutes, and observe for any fever or reactions, and then you go with the prehydration. So prehydration 500 ml NS over 30 minutes to reduce the risk of renal toxicity and hypokalemia. 500 ml normal saline plus 1 ampule 20 millimole of KCl we can add, and according to the doctor's prescription. And therapeutic dose 5 to 10 mg per kg per day amphotericin B in 500 ml of 5% dextrose with 10 units of human insulin regular over 3 hours. And it should be covered with the black sheet for photosensitivity. And post hydration, 500 ml of NS over 30 minutes. And you should watch for urine output and renal function test after every dose, each dose. After each dose, you should watch for urine output and renal function test, and fill the amphotericin monitoring sheet. So in the right side, you can see the amphotericin B chart. You should enter the starting time and the ending time, and which dose, first dose, second dose, so which dose, and cumulative dose, and urea creatinine value, and sodium potassium report, and SGOT, SGPT report, and any complication that have been observed during the period of infusion therapy. And in the left side, you could see that step down or salvage therapy in patients who cannot tolerate amphotericin B due to severe renal impairment, allergy, or several cases for cerebral mucormycosis, we can go with posaconazole or isavuconazole. So injection posaconazole is 300 mg IV BD per oral day one, followed by 300 mg OD for 4 to 6 weeks. Or isavuconazole 200 mg IV TID oral 2 days, followed by 200 mg IV OD oral for 4 to 6 weeks. So these are all the surgical management. So I'm not going to cover all these surgical management. So what is the major nurse's role in all these surgical management? First one is consent. So as a nurse, we should take part in the getting the informed consent from the patient. And the surgical site marking, whether the surgery site preoperatively, we should note that, ensure that whether the surgical site has been marked or not. And it should cover both the side, which side the surgery is going to done, that you should mark in the that should be marked, and as well as the site marking also to be done. And WHO safety checklist should be completed prior to surgery, and obtaining fitness for surgery from all the departments like ID team on general medicine and neurosurgery. So according to the site of involvement, you should get the fitness for surgery according to the primary consultants. And NPO status and pre-op medications. So in the pre-op medications, the test dose of the medication should be completed. So role of nurse in counseling. So you should counsel the patient with do's and don'ts for prevention of mucormycosis. The do's: keeping the unit or house clean and dry, and keep the cut injuries clean and covered, and keep the fridge clean at all the times. Wear shoes, long pants and long sleeved shirt when doing outdoor activities like gardening, and wear gloves when handling of materials such as soil, moss or manure. And don'ts: do not stay in the dust site like construction or excavation site, or wear N95 mask during these times, and do not have direct contact with water damaged buildings or flood water, and do not have close contact with soil or dust such as yard work or gardening, and do not store food for longer period of time in the fridge or reuse. And role of nurse in reassessment and follow-up. First thing is reconsideration and readmission criteria, in that during the discharge, you should reassess the patient, the level of saturation in the positioning, like sitting or sitting, and supine position. And then you have to ensure that the SpO2 level, and you have to teach them about the readmission criteria and all the symptoms that you have to teach to the patient. And consideration: if patients discharge on home oxygen, you should teach them if there is a humidifier along with the oxygen in the home setup, that should be filled with sterile water. And for infection control practices, you should teach about the hand hygiene, and then social distancing, and then mask, and how to clean the mask, and prevention of contamination. And for the medication has to take at the right time, at the right dose, and do not skip the medication. And then dietary advices: educate the patient to take more vitamin C rich foods and protein rich foods. And if the patient is a known case of diabetic, advise them about the diabetic diet. And exercise: educate them about the exercise tolerance level, and then how to make a simple exercise, then to the aggressive exercise. And the follow-up care, at least for a month, they have to give a follow-up. So we can prevent by taking some of the steps, this mucormycosis, and the environmental cleanliness, to have no exposure of decaying organic matters like bread, fruits or vegetables or soil, compost or excreta. And the strict control of hyperglycemia is important, as it is a predisposing factor or the risk factor. And glucose monitoring in COVID-19 patients requiring steroid therapy. It is important for the COVID-19 patient, as it is one of the risk factor. And optimally steroid usage, the right time of initiation, right dose and the right duration. And use sterile water for humidifiers during oxygen therapy. If in hospital, avoid using any type of water from oxygen port. Appropriate usage of antifungals and antibiotics, and simple tests like a pupillary reaction, ocular motility, sinus tenderness and palatal examination to be done as a nurse as a part of a routine physical evaluation of COVID-19 patient for early detection of mucormycosis. So this is a case study. Mr. X, 29 years old male. On April 17, he was tested positive through RT-PCR and was admitted in GH hospital in hometown due to desaturation. And his primary symptoms were myalgia and fever, and hospitalized for about 29 days and was on ventilator for about 13 days. And on post-discharge also with continuous oxygen support with 3 liters through nasal prongs. And the patient has maintained SpO2 of 96% with the 3 liter of oxygen. And he came to ER with a history of fever and cough on May 24, 2021 and was admitted in COVID unit and was on NRBM due to desaturation. During the hospital stay of 8th day, he had an episode of epistaxis in the left nostril. Patient was assessed and CTPNS with contrast was done, and the findings were bilateral maxillary ethmoid right frontal sinusitis, in maxillary sinus heterogeneous opacification and aquary fungal deposition. To rule out the fungal invasion, nasal endoscopy was done and found to have thick mucus with whitish debris and a right middle meatus bloody crust with polypoidal mucosa. In middle meatus, bilateral fungal sinusitis. So endoscopic debridement of bilateral fungal sinusitis was done on June 4, 2021, and tissue and pus culture sent for confirmation, and the report was mucormycosis, and he is on antifungal therapy. So here we are using injection Cresemba, isavuconazole IV 200 mg, TDS for 6 doses completed for the patient, and followed by he is on treatment of tablet Cresemba, that is isavuconazole per oral 200 mg OD. These are the references. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Deepika, for an elaborate presentation on mucormycosis. And at this point of time, we also thank your nursing director, Ma'am Jyoti Clara Michael, and also your chief nursing officer, Mrs. Rajula, for deputing you to be the resource person for our webinar. Kindly extend our warm thanks to your director and the CNO, ma'am. Thank you, Deepika. I think you can stop sharing your presentation so that we will move on to the next agenda.
Yes, thank you.
So the next speaker on our agenda is Ms. Asunta Jonsi. She has graduated from St. Martha's College of Nursing, Bangalore. She started her career as staff nurse at PSG hospitals. She has also worked in various cadres like nursing tutor and occupational nurse at the Indian Public School. Presently, she is the nurse educator of PSG hospitals since the year 2018. Asunta, I welcome you to take over the session.
Yeah, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good and His love endures forever. Yes, definitely. God has been gracious and He's blessed us with this day. So we thank God. Every morning brings you new hopes, new opportunities, make it worth. To everybody listening to this virtual webinar, each day we wake up to is definitely a new opportunity to do better, to live a better life. So good morning to everyone. So today's topic given to me was mucormycosis in COVID-19 patients, a narration. Just a second. So I'm going to narrate about a patient, a case study. So I will be going through the journey of the patient, X, the recent history, the emergency management. Okay, I'll just put it down. Sorry. Results of the past medical history, physical examination, the laboratory test, the treatment, the course of patient in the hospital, and nursing care. So about my patient, now that you all have already listened to the doctor's speech and we had another speaker, Ms. Deepika, about the same topic, I think we need to correlate now. It's a narration, so it's like a story. I want you all to imagine, as we go through this patient, we need to correlate with what the doctor said about the disease condition. Yeah, so patient X is a 56-year-old with a past history of past medical history of hypertension and hypothyroidism. And the patient presented with the complaints of left eye swelling, left-sided numbness of the cheek and periorbital area, and nasal discharge. So these are correlating with the symptoms of mucormycosis. And it was there for 3 days. One second. Slide three.
Change
slide, Lama.
Name slide.
Now it's okay. You can go ahead.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, are my slides changing?
It's okay, changing.
Okay, so I think this slide was not visible. I will be going through the journey of patient with the recent history emergency department course. The past medical history, physical examination, as I've repeated already. So yeah, I was talking about my journey of patient X, a 56-year-old with a history of hypertension and hypothyroidism, came with the complaints of left eye swelling, left-sided numbness of the cheek and periorbital area, and nasal discharge since 3 days. So the recent history is, patient was diagnosed as COVID positive on 30th April, was treated in an outside hospital, and was discharged on 10th May. Since that evening itself, patient has developed left eye swelling, left nasal discharge, and numbness of the cheek and periorbital area. The nasal discharge was bloodstained. This was a warning sign. Doctor had said that we need to look out for any bloodstained or changed in color, the nasal discharge. And we also need to see this patient was recently diagnosed with type 2 diabetes mellitus. The emergency department course, the reason for me to include this here is the patient was discharged on the 10th May from the COVID care unit. And though she had complaints on the same day, she came to the emergency department only on the 12th May with a similar complaints as I mentioned earlier. And the patient refused admission, though she was advised to get admitted. And later she came back on the 14th saying she wanted an ENT consultation, an OP consultation. We should understand at this situation, any person who wants to come to the hospital is scared. Even for a routine checkup, they are scared to come to the hospital. And this patient has been in the hospital from 15th April. She's been in the hospital for almost 10-15 days. And another hospitalization, they will be thinking of the financial issues and, you know, a rehospitalization. So this mindset has made them defer admission. And she came back on the 14th for admission. We have lost almost 4 days in her treatment since she has started symptoms of mucormycosis. The past history I've mentioned already, and there was no other significant history. So moving on to the physical examination, I would like to tell about the very important physical examination of my patient. That is, the patient had visual acuity, visual field, and the color of the vision was normal in the right. But in the left eye, when she came, she had no perception of light, which means she could hardly see anything. She could not even perceive light. So this has almost moved to an advanced stage, and it was not in the initial stage. Okay, and she also had this chemosis, which is the inflammation of the conjunctiva, and proptosis, which you can see is the abnormal protrusion of the eyeballs. And she also had blackish discoloration and dental caries in her mouth, and mostly on the left side. And the other two pictures below are the endoscopic pictures, which show the blackish or the fungal growth in the nasal cavity. So this was the specific physical examination I would like to mention regarding my patient. Moving on to the next slide, I would like to explain about the laboratory investigations. I've mentioned a few. In this, what we need to see is the patient's urea, serum urea nitrogen, and creatinine were elevated throughout from the day of her admission till the day, the last day of her hospitalization. It was continuously increasing. This also shows that her she has an acute kidney injury, and her electrolytes were also imbalanced. We also see that her HB is dropping. We had a culture sent, which showed cephalococcus. So that means she's into sepsis. So when a patient is into sepsis, obviously their blood counts decrease. And I had mentioned she's type 2 diabetes mellitus, recently diagnosed. But when we see her HbA1c, it was high. So the last 3 months average value shows that she had missed her symptoms of diabetes mellitus, probably because of fear of not wanting to come to the hospital, or anxiety and fear missing the signs and symptoms. So we need to be very, very specific in this pandemic, especially when we are fighting, you know, COVID and mucormycosis. We need to see if we have, if the patients or people around us are aware about the symptoms of high blood sugar. We also see her glucose fasting levels are also high, and it's been fluctuating. She was on insulin. I will deal about the medications in the coming slides. Ferritin. Ferritin, as doctor had said, it's very, very important for the fungus to grow. In a human body, especially mammals, we don't actually have free ferritin in the blood available for this fungi to grow. But COVID-19 infection causes the blood ferritin level to increase. And we see also the total iron binding capacity is low. So obviously, in this situation, the ferritin is aiding the mucormycosis to grow in the human body, making it a culture media. So I'd like, the next thing we would be seeing is her histopathological report. I will just go on with the diagnosis part, and then we will go day by day about how my patient was treated, so you can correlate. Histopathological report, as it is shown, she was confirmed to have the mucormycosis, and which was invasive, tissue invasive, is the pathological report. The next we see, the first two images on top are the CT reports of my patient. The one which I'm showing now, which has a mentioned A, was taken on the 14th, the day of her admission. And the next image was taken on the next day. And the last two images were taken on the 20th May. So we can see there is extensive progression of the disease. We can see here as I'm pointing out. So I would like to just mention a few points about the CT reports. The mucosal thickening we can see here in the first image. And in the second image, we are able to see how well the eye is damaged and the mucor has been invasive. And in the last two images, it has been progressive. We can see the facial structures being destroyed by the mucor. And here in the fourth image, you're able to see there is extensive involvement of the brain. So the report says mass effect is seen compressing the brain stem, narrowing fourth ventricle, tonsillar herniation noted through the foramen magnum. There's also an abscess evolving in the cerebral, left cerebral hemisphere. And the impression overall is rhino-orbital cerebral and cerebellar mucormycosis. So unfortunately, we lost this patient, the patient I've chosen for the case study. Yes, because she delayed in her hospitalization, and the treatment could not progress because we were losing her. As doctor said, it is a very devastating and it is a very dangerous disease. So the next, I would like to just discuss the medication that my patient was getting. I would just like to emphasize on certain points from the nursing aspect on these medications. We all know that sugar levels or the blood sugar levels are one reason for it, you know, for the mucormycosis to thrive. So what I would like to say is the patient will be getting any agent to reduce the blood sugars. Over here, my patient was getting humanitarid infusion, and later she was getting the patient was getting subcutaneously. So we need to see the site rotation is very, very important when giving insulin to a patient, and when loading an infusion, humanitarid infusion, also the nurses have to be very, very careful. And the continuous checking of GRBS or the blood sugars, however we are doing it, it should be monitored properly. We all know insulin is a high-risk medication, so we have a very important responsibility as nurses when we are handling such patients. Next, I would like to talk about the amphotericin. The previous speaker has given a very elaborate talk on the amphotericin, so I'm not going very detailed. What I would like to mention is we do not reconstitute it with any other solution other than dextrose 5%. So we have to be very careful. We do not reconstitute with anything else. And then we need to make sure that the IV cannula or the CVC line, which has the amphotericin on flow, should be flushed before and after with 5% dextrose initially, because there can be a reaction, and the flushing techniques are very, very important when we are administering medications. So the next, I'm not going very in depth. We've already lost a lot of time. Main thing, NAC NSAID cysteine was given because the patient's creatinine was on the rise, we have seen already, and even her LFT was deranged. We had done only one LFT, that was also quite deranged. So the patient was continued on NAC. The other important thing I would like to say is when we are starting on amphotericin, the patient has high affinity or the chances of going into having a fever, a headache, and chills is very, very likely. So the patient was on Dolo and Avil to prevent the, any allergic reaction. And as I said before, patient had staphylococcus, so we had started her on meropenem. And morphine, I will let you know why we started off with morphine in the course of her admission or in the hospitalization. So course of my patient, as I said, she was admitted with the complaints of nasal discharge, numbness, and later on day two, she developed giddiness, headache, myalgia, and drowsiness. On day two itself, she desaturated. Therefore, we had to start her on 4-liter oxygen. Her CVC line was, a catheter was inserted, her bladder was catheterized. And as sir was saying, the doctor was telling early debridement or the early surgical intervention. The next day itself, she was posted for endoscopic debridement, and the lateral walls of her maxilla were thrombosed, and inferior turbinate mucosa was completely black. That is showing the growth. And the middle turbinate was thrombosed and necrosed, so they had to remove it. And the septal mucosa also was black. So they had to do extensive debridement to remove the necrosed and thrombosed tissue. We all know mucormycosis is a angioinvasive fungi. Angioinvasive is, it takes up the ferritin, and then there was a picture in Sir's presentation which explained how well it is angioinvasive. So the mucormycosis, it just invades the blood vessels and then it forms thrombosis. So when it forms thrombosis, it prevents the blood flow, and therefore there is cell death, necrosis. Even the bone tissue dies necrosing. So we have to remove the bony structures as well. So on day three, after it was a post-op day one, the patient was having dressing, the nasal packs were removed, and it was checked. And nasal packs were again re-established so that, and it was all soaked in amphotericin B. We use this as a topical medicine in wound dressing also, so that we can, prevent the extensive growth of the fungi. This patient was also given a retrobulbar amphotericin B injection after proper consent from the patient's relatives. But still, as her condition was deteriorating, we see she was also into sepsis and acute kidney injury. We could not go into more surgical intervention, and that is why we could not go into her, we could not remove the eye, or it is called the excentration. We couldn't do that. And therefore, as we see, as I said in earlier in my slides with the radiological image, her brain was affected. So this mucormycosis has literally taken away the patient by extensive growth. So on day four, what happened was the patient was, as I said, was on oxygen. She deteriorated. She had a cardiac arrest. We had to give her CPR, adrenaline doses, and yes, she came back. But then she was ventilated, and she continued to be on ventilator with FiO2 50% on the initial days, and progressively, though we reduced the FiO2 to 30%, her condition was deteriorating. And finally, on day 11, we lost the patient to mucormycosis. I took up this patient because a lot of patients do not come in the initial stages. So I would like to emphasize, early the better. The treatment course, when we started off early, it's very, very easy to prevent the extensive damage which mucormycosis causes. And to talk about nurses, yes, in the journey of any patient in an hospital, I think the vital person is a nurse, and we should be very proud. I would like to say that being a nurse, I know it's difficult, but it is okay to be an ordinary nurse. But to be a special nurse, to feel special, you have to be a smart and knowledgeable nurse. We need to keep updating our knowledge on the recent events and the patient care. So let's see how a vital nurse, how a nurse plays a vital role in our patient. So from my point of view, I would like to emphasize the nursing care on four aspects. That is control. Because as doctor said, we are not able to prevent it completely. So we are, at least we can try to control the situation. And early detection, rehabilitation, and care of affected patients. We will see this one by one. Yes, so under control, we all know right now what we're dealing is mucormycosis, which is associated with COVID-19. So researchers have been published saying that diabetes mellitus, steroid use, and oxygen is one common thing. We are not saying this is the cause of mucormycosis, because all this has been here for decades, and mucormycosis was very rare. But right now, these three are associated with the mucormycosis currently with the second wave. So as nurses, when a patient comes to a COVID care unit with diabetes mellitus, we should maintain the blood sugar levels. We should put in the efforts of educating them and maintain their diet. So we are able to maintain their blood sugar values in a near optimum levels. And steroid, judicial use, I'm sure we have no other resource right now, because we need the steroid to save the lung. But then when we use the steroid, the blood sugars are high. So we have to be judicial in the use of steroids and tapering the steroidal dose. In the hospital, we give IV injections, but then when the patient goes back home, we send them with tapering doses of oral steroids. The patient has to be explained. Not all patients will know, okay, the first few days we have to take this much, and the next few days we have to take these many tablets. This is very, very important, the education to the patient. Nurses, as nurses, we need to start talking to the patient more. We have a lot of work. We are burdened with so much of the pressure of the pandemic, but we have to give time to talk to the patient and educate them. Next is oxygen. Yes, as doctor said, there is a controversial topic going on, the industrial oxygenation and the medical oxygenation. Yes, but what we could do, we cannot go and say we need medical oxygenation. Whatever we get is we are going to use. So as nurses, we can definitely clean the mask or the cannula or whatever method we are using to administer oxygen can be cleaned every day. It can be placed in a proper area or in a very clean space. I would also like to emphasize on boosting the patient's immunity. There is a lot of information on the internet. People get confused. We see our own family members calling and saying, adu pannama, idu pannama, can we do this? Can we do that? We need to have evidence, or we need to have a scientific background behind it. And we need to tell them. We should not ask them to overdo. Now we see patients taking steam every often, where every hourly they are taking. That is highly not recommended. And the abuse of medications, the over-counter drugs, these all should be explained to the patient. And certain humidifiers at a certain level of oxygenation we do not use. Higher oxygenation, a higher percentage of oxygenation, we do use humidifier. So obviously we are giving the best care to the patient, but we need to have an extra eye to see if the humidifier and the methods of oxygen administration are clean. And fear and anxiety is also a cause for, you know, the increase in the blood sugar level. So we need to talk to them, the fear of the disease, the loss of a loved one, or, you know, the fear of death or fear of black fungus itself. So we need to give psychological support. Next is early detection. In early detection, I would like to explain about the clinical signs and symptoms we've already gone through, but I would like to explain once again: the abdominal black discharge, bleeding from the nose, nasal block, headache, eye pain, swelling around the eyes, double vision, redness of the eyes, and prominence of the eyes. All this, if they have, it should not, and a stuffed nose or blocked nose. People say, I will take steam, it will become all right. No, we should educate the patient about the signs and symptoms of mucormycosis. We should tell them, we are not scaring you. COVID, when a patient comes for the COVID itself, we should not scare the patient by saying, like, you know, these are the signs and symptoms. But we can explain to them in a very simple and understandable way that they are not scared of the disease, but they have the awareness. Creating fear has no use in it, but creating awareness is very, very different. I would say there is a lot of fear in patients through media, social media, the news, and everything they see. But as nurses, we should not create a fear in them, but we have to create awareness in them. And personal hygiene. We all, the patients, once they are out of COVID, we see in the news also and in the social media, I'm back, I've survived COVID. I'm back into my gym classes. I'm back into my activities. I'm hale and healthy. Our body needs time for rest and to recover. So immediately after post-COVID, you're going into activities which involves exposing yourself to dust, to the mud, to the soil, or any dirty area can predispose ourselves. Though we are already immunocompromised, we have had medications, we are on steroids, and then again into activities which increase the factor of mucormycosis. So we need to look into that also. So we have to explain to the patient that they need to take rest and they need to give time for the body to recover post-COVID. And as the previous speaker had said, use of gloves, full sleeves, proper hygiene. They need to have proper bath, nail care, and oral care. I forgot to mention one thing. Patients on oxygen, they tend to cough a lot when they are off oxygen, probably when they are eating or they use the restroom. So they try to minimize that because they go into a state of hypoxia when they are off oxygen. So we need to look into their mouth care. They might not be giving a lot of importance into their oral care while they are on oxygen in COVID. So we need to see to their, we can give them a chlorhexidine mouthwash or betadine mouthwash so that they are able to at least gargle, though they're not able to go to the restroom and brush, or we can do it in the bedside for the patient. We can definitely help them. The instruments that need to be used should be sterile. The mask should be cleaned every day. The floor cleaning also should be looked into by the nurses. Yes, the housekeeping are doing their best right now, but then we also need to have an eye on that. Next, the nursing care, I would like to emphasize here, medical intervention, we've already spoken about amphotericin. I would like to talk about posaconazole, which is an oral drug right now, because we know, as doctor also said, we are not able to get amphotericin B, 80 to 84 vials we need to give one patient, but which is right now, it's not available. So we are switching over to oral drugs. This posaconazole is to be given with food, 300 mg, that is three tablets. One tablet is 100 mg. We give three tablets with food. We give it with food because the absorption is higher. These medications also have hepatotoxicity, but in order to save the patients, we have to start them off. Surgical intervention, they do functional endoscopic sinus surgery, that is FES, and they do a DNE, diagnostic nasal endoscopy. Any patient with mucormycosis, once their surgical intervention is done, they keep coming every second day to either in the inpatient setup, or if they are luckily they're going home, they come back every other day for this diagnostic nasal endoscopy. The doctors continuously clean the cavity with saline, and they remove the debris or if there is any left out necrose tissue and any mucormycosis growth. It's very, very difficult because the patient is sitting when they are doing this DNE, and they have to tolerate the scope going in and the suctioning and the debridement and the cleaning. So we need to explain to the patient regarding this and prepare them for this procedures. And complications. The complications are divided into two: the disease-related complications and the treatment-related complications. Disease-related complications are devastating because once we do not go in the right path, or we might lose our patient. So cavernous sinus thrombosis, disseminated infection, and periorbital destruction, and further leading to death. Cavernous sinus thrombosis. This is the sinus which draws the blood from the brain and brings it back to the heart. So if there is a thrombosis there, and definitely we will be losing the neurological functions, leading to the death of the patient. The other complication in the treatment is prolonged hospitalization. We've already seen that, you know, we 14 days we give IV, and then another 45 days we have to go on with the oral antifungals. It's quite long. And with mucormycosis being so invasive, the patient's minimal, say the hospitalized stay is more than 3 weeks. Right now we have quite a number of patients here, and most of them are here for weeks. And rehabilitation. We know the debridement makes the patient lose a lot of their bony structures as well as their facial structures. We've had patients losing almost 8 teeth at one time when they go in for the surgery. Their jaws are trimmed off because they're necrosed. Their mandible is removed, or any structure, any bony structure is removed. And then only the skin flap after the debridement and after the removal of the mucormycosis is, you know, sutured back. It gives a very bad deformed look to the patient. We need to rehabilitate them psychologically and physically. Physically, we need to strengthen the muscles. There is no bony structure to support the muscle structure or the skin. So we need to provide extensive facial, not immediately, later. We need to give them facial muscle strengthening exercises so that when they are off this fungal infection, probably we can give them prostheses, and that will help them to, you know, have a better life. The next thing, living with the deformity also, if they are not able to do the implants, then we need to help them in feeding themselves, because sometimes the palate is removed, there's a hole over there, eating will also be a very difficult situation. So we need to rehabilitate the patient. One thing I would like to mention here is the nurse's psychological mentality also. We are into a pandemic, caring for COVID patients and mucormycosis. The patients come back with terribly deformed facial structures, and we need to take time for ourselves also. And then only when we are psychologically healthy, I think we can give awareness to the patient. I would like to just emphasize on certain things, since my patient was ventilated, and this will be my last points which I would like to talk about before we finish off this presentation. Yes, patient's oral care is important. I'm emphasizing on the oral care. And when the patient, sometimes they're very tired, fatigued, so positioning, we should not let them have any other like DVT or back bed sore because of their prolonged hospitalization, or they are not bedridden, but they tend to stay in the bed for a long time. If they are on ventilator, we need to give the ventilator care, catheter care, because my patient was catheterized. I'm mentioning this. If they deteriorate, usually patients with mucormycosis in their current situation, they are deteriorating quite fast. So we need to take care of their other needs as well. We need to perform hand hygiene, because we should not be a source of infection, and we should not be cross-contaminating our patients and ourselves also. Yes, so these are some points that I finally wanted to emphasize. I would like to thank everybody, the program coordinators, the principal, nursing superintendent, my family, and above all, God Almighty, for this opportunity. Thank you, participants, for your patient listening. Yeah, thank you. Any questions?
Thank you, Ashanta, for sharing your experience. It was very practical. I think we have come to end of this webinar. Mucormycosis into the COVID field made it a double whammy. It's an older disease in a new avatar, which hardly had any chance of mentioning during the first COVID wave in India, is now grabbing news headlines with a mounting number of cases being associated with COVID-19, which left behind many unanswered questions. Hope this webinar provided plausible explanations for the changed scenario. At this occurrence, I would like to thank renowned resource persons for shared their expertise knowledge with us. I would like to thank Principal for her leading supervision and inspiring at every point of time. I want to extend my generous thanks to the entire crew worked behind to make this event a successful one. Also, I would like to appreciate the passion and involvement of all the participants throughout the session. Thank you, one and all. I request all the participants to fill the feedback form so that the certificate will be generated. Thank you once again.